Well, Pratt, thank you for having us. We're here at Leyton Orient training ground. We're going to take a look back at your Swans career way back when. So we'll go back to 2006. Your last game before you joined the Swans was actually against the Swans for Brentford in the League One playoffs.
Yeah.
What did you think of Swansea at that point?
Well, we went up to Swansea to play the first leg, see the stadium, because I was going to sign for Swansea actually that season before. But I had a good time at Brentford, enjoyed it, so I didn't end up going. And then we got used in the playoffs. I think it was a 1-1 draw in the first leg. Second leg brought you back to our place. And I remember, I think, Leon Knight, Truns and all them. So I thought the Swans, for a League One club, the players they had, the front four, Bayo, Rory, Truns, Leon, I thought, the season that you beat us, I wanted, obviously, you used to win in the final. But, I wanted to join us. One thing I wanted to do as soon as the game was over, I said to my agent, if we can get to Swansea, that'd be ideal for me.
You knew Chris Coleman, he was your gaffer at Fulham.
Yeah.
Did you talk to him about the club and the city before you came?
Well, he spoke to me, like I said, the year before. And he said Swansea, because he was a player down there, played for Wales. And he said, you'd love it down there. But I'd never heard of Swansea. And I was like, Swansea, do I really want to go that far? I'm a London boy, always lived in London. So the second season when he came up to me and said, you're not probably going to be in the first team at Fulham. I think it'd be ideal for you to go. And then, it was the best thing. It was probably the best thing I've ever done in my career, to be honest. Joining Swansea, leaving London, especially for off the pitch, is a lot of distractions. And to go and sign for a club in Swansea and go on the career we had, it was massive.
So Kenny brought you in. He's someone you know very well. He obviously brought you to Leyton Orient as well.
Yeah.
Do you think he's sometimes the forgotten man in Swansea's story and the rise through the league?
Yeah, because I don't know the players he brought in before, but he had a good time, good team, in the squad that he assembled at that time. He brought in a lot of players to that club. And we was all shocked when he left. He left, I think, halfway through the season. I think he said he took the club as far as he could. So we was a little bit shocked. I was disappointed because he brought me in and made me captain when Gary Monk was out. So he does get forgotten because obviously the rise of the club in the space of time when he left. It's a bit like we did here, to be honest. He made a lot of good signings. It didn't really work out for him, but the majority of the team that plays the squad is his players. So he does know his stuff, and it just didn't work out for him at Swansea, a bit like it didn't here.
So your Swans debut, we won't talk about the result. we played Cheltenham.
Yeah, I remember the
game. Of that squad, of the starting 11 and all the subs, you were the only player to still be playing. Are you thankful to still be playing at the age of 37?
Yeah, I didn't know that. It's quite a nice stat. I'm grateful to be playing. I love playing football. I look after myself. And I think my enthusiasm for the game is what keeps me going. I'm in a good team at the moment who look like we're going for promotion. So that helps. But yeah, I want to play as long as I can. We were just talking before about coaching. I've done my coaching badges, so that'd be something I want to try and transition into a coach.
Sounds a bit random, but when I was doing my research for this, I noticed your third ever game for the Swans was a 1-0 loss to Oldham. None other than your current manager, Richie Wellens, was playing against us that day.
Yeah.
Is that crazy when you think about that now?
Yeah, it is crazy because obviously playing against Richie all through my career, when he was at Donny, like you said, Oldham. You told me just before we come on that he beat us that day, so I'll keep that quiet. But for someone you've been playing against to actually manager, because normally managers are a lot older than you, so it's not too far difference in age. But he's done a great job here and he'll go on and do massive things throughout his career. But it is a bit weird, like you said, used to play against him and now he's telling me which way to run and shouting at me and moaning at me. So, yeah, it is a bit weird in that sense.
So, February 2007, Kenny resigned and Roberto became manager. Mm. Now, he brought in quite a unique style of play, something that not many people had seen at that time.
Yeah.
How did you find adapting to that and what was it like playing under him?
Well, when he first came in, I was injured at the first part of his games. So he tried to get his ideas across, the way he wanted to play. And it was a massive difference, because back in the day, League One football was second balls, long balls, and not really much playing football on the floor. He'd come in straight away, he started doing passing drills, and I couldn't believe it. His actual training was probably to this day, probably the best I've ever seen. And what he done well was he got the buy-in from the fans, because when you're playing football, a bit like at the moment at Swansea, when things ain't going well, the fans start getting a bit upset and saying, attack, attack, attack. But he was saying, don't worry, I want you to be patient, carry on playing. And we managed to do that. We had good players at the time, but he took the club on massively from where we were before in terms of the way we play. And that style's stayed with the club for 15, 16 years since I've left.
The following season, 2007-2008, you won the first of four promotions in your career so far, and the Swans were crowned champions of League One.
Yeah.
At the time, could you get a sense of, you know, this was just the start for Swansea?
Yeah, because it's the only club I've been at, really, where I used to go at every game and never think I was going to lose. And if we did lose, it'd be like, oh, it's just a little blip, we'll win the next one. It was crazy. We used to come to Liberty Stadium, do the same routine, and it was a blonde woman and a man. I don't know. Sometimes when I watch the games, they're still there. I used to see them. It used to be all the time. There's a little girl. We used to go and give her a kiss before the game.
Yeah.
And I knew it was a club on the up, and it was used to winning games. It was a tight knit squad, and I knew it was going to be special at that club.
So the following season was your first season in the Championship.
Yeah.
And we played our first League South Wales derby in 9 years.
Yeah.
In true Darren Pratley fashion, cometh the hour, cometh the man.
Yeah.
You scored.
Yeah.
Could you get a feeling of how much those games meant to the Jack Army?
Yeah. I missed the game before that because we played them in the cup, and Jordi Gomez. That's I was it. Watching the game, and I don't know if I was injured or suspended, and I was jealous. I was jealous of the boys because the atmosphere that day, I'd never seen nothing like it. So when we got into the Championship and we had them that day, obviously when you're walking around and you see all the fans telling you how much it means, and Toosey, I don't know if he still goes there.
He's still around.
Toosey on the halfway line used to say to us, if you score, come and celebrate with us. And I managed to score, like you said, and then my celebration, which I won't go into much because the Cardiff fans don't like me for it. But they were special days, and I still remember them now, and I still play them to the boys here, and they get fed up with that.
Now, I think the craziest stat I saw when looking this up was after that 2-2 draw,
yep,
you didn't score for 342 days.
There's a shot.
Until the next time we play Cardiff at home,
yep,
you scored two.
Yep.
Did you just seem to thrive off these big games?
I used to love them, and what I love now is it was always early kickoffs because of the fan trouble, so it was like 11 o'clock. I hate waiting around. So you wake up early in the morning, you kick off at 11 o'clock, the atmosphere, the buzz. I used to live on the marina, so I used to see all the fans driving in. And I met the commentator says at the time when I scored a goal, he hasn't scored in how long it was. And I used to love them games, especially that game as well when I scored two. I think it went 2-2, and then to get the winner, Paulo Sousa, who I really enjoyed as a manager. I used to love them games. Yeah. They were the best games I've ever played in.
Now, I heard one story of Paulo Sousa,
yeah,
when you were in hospital having an operation on your shoulder.
Yeah, yeah.
And when you woke up, he was the first person there.
Yeah, and that sticks with me. Now, like I said, hopefully I can play for a bit longer, but when I transition into a coach, I would like to treat my players as people. He didn't have to come. I'd never played for him. He came and saw me in hospital, and he was telling me stories about his career, his life. And I thought that was amazing, especially when you wake up for an operation. I never played for him before. He was a manager that I really respected just for that. And then when I got back, I wanted to do well and play well, and I managed finishing the top scorer that season with seven goals. Which ain't great, but for me, seven goals to finish top goal scorer was good.
So the next season then, Brendan came in.
Yeah.
What were your first impressions of him?
Didn't really know too much about him, but like again, like Roberto, his training sessions were a joke. Some was doing like one touch training sessions and falling over your feet, didn't know how to cope with them. But I could tell straight away he had his authority. He used to talk about his time at Chelsea quite a lot with the boys. Again, wanted to play the same sort of style as Roberto. And he had an aura about him that he was confident. He's got that aura. Sometimes it can come across as cockiness if you don't know him. but he just knew he was going to be a good manager and take us on to that next step.
You know where I'm going next. I'm so excited to talk about this. So we had Forest in the playoff semi-finals.
Yeah.
We were 2-0 up at home. Yeah. Earnshaw pulled the goal back. So yeah. Getting pretty tense.
Yeah.
So they have a corner. Everyone's laughing, including their keeper.
Yeah.
McGugan miskicks his shot. You pick the ball up and you just charge towards goal and curl it in from the halfway line. Yeah. Was that one of the best goals of your career?
Yeah, it was the best. It's probably the best moment in my career. Still now, like you said, they were probably on top. Could have maybe scored from a corner. No, before that they could have scored. And then, when I'm running down the line, hearing the crowd shout and shoot. Brendan Rodgers telling me to run it into the corner. And then pulled out my big curly toe, from the Kings, and then managed to get a good connection on it and go in. And the roar from when we scored, my missus was outside the stadium. She didn't go to the game, and she heard it, and she was saying to him, one of the stewards, "Oh, who scored?" And he's like, in a Welsh accent, "Darren Pratley." And she was like, obviously she was buzzing as well. So best probably moment of my career. The atmosphere was a joke.
But Gazza had some influence on that goal too.
Yeah, Gazza, yeah. But I've said before in interviews before, Gazza missed, he was doing something for charity at half time on one of the games, and he had to knock the ball from the halfway line into the goal, and he kept on missing. And I always thought, why don't you just curl it in? Because it's quite hard to go straight all the way. The ball is going to have some sort of movement on it. And if I didn't see that before, I probably would have probably gone straight, and then you never know, they could have had extra time, or they could have gone down the other end and scored or whatever.
Now, we've spoken about a lot of the positives, but towards the end of that season, you lost your starting place.
Yep.
You didn't even start that game. No. I heard one podcast where you said on the day of that game, you were throwing stones against the wall of your house because you were so frustrated.
Yep.
How hard a time was that in your career?
Yeah, it was tough. Don't get me wrong, we had good players who were playing ahead of me, in Stephen Doby, Joe Allen. But I had a lot of issues with my contract at the time, which has been documented. I went in to sign a contract. It was completely different to what we agreed. So in the end, I said, I'll wait till the end of the season. So I was in and out of the team. That day of the day, now my preparation, all throughout my career, my preparation was in bed, have a sleep, wake up. I think my missus was outside washing the car, and I'm sitting throwing stones up against the wall in the marina. Something I wouldn't do, especially for a big game like that. And then I obviously ended up doing well and coming on and scoring. But it was frustrating towards the end when you're not playing. The final, I probably enjoyed the League One promotion more than I did the Championship promotion. And that's crazy because it's a much bigger thing. But I felt more part of the League One promotion than I did. And I probably had a better season in terms of scoring goals. I scored 11 goals that season. But when you don't start in big games, you don't really feel part of it. And I didn't feel part of it. And that was a disappointment to end at the end like that.
Was it hard leaving Swansea? You'd obviously bought a house there. It was somewhere that got quite close to your heart.
Yeah, loved it. I love Swansea. I still do now. I thought I'd end up retiring there. Obviously, I was still young, 25. Like I said, I had a house on the marina. My dog, we should take my dog over to the sea for a run every night. I used to eat in Vesuvio's, Paco's, the boys were a close-knit group. And I noticed that when I did leave, we all used to eat together. So we'd go for Vesuvio in the evening, have our food, get a takeaway. Everyone was close. We used to live, is it Birch Grove and on the marina, where when you go to other clubs, you all live different places. You don't really have that connection, but we had a massive connection at Swansea. So it was hard to leave. And I haven't been back since. I only went back to sell the house when we played against Swansea in the Premier League. And obviously when we played against you in the Champ and League One, wherever it was. But like I said to you just a bit before, I'd like to go back and go and see it, go watch a game and see the new training ground. A bit different to a gym we used to train in. And it will always have a place in my heart. Swansea's, it was the best time of my career.
So you went to Bolton that summer.
Yeah.
And surprise, surprise, first goal for Bolton
came against
the Swans in January.
Yeah.
Was that bittersweet?
It was, because I didn't score. I was in and out of the team. Wasn't really enjoying it. Didn't really like the area I was living in too much. Like I said, everyone's all over the place. Didn't really know the club. And then, managed to score. I think the goal might have been offside. But I didn't celebrate, and the fans were giving me a bit of stick as well. They were giving me a bit of stick because Bolton were struggling at the time. So yeah, I was happy to get my first goal, but it was against the, obviously against Swansea, so I didn't celebrate because I had 5 great years there. But yeah, I even forgot about that goal, to be honest. Yeah. That's how much it didn't really mean too much to me, yeah, because it was against Swansea.
So you're here now, Leyton Orient.
Yeah.
Things are going pretty well this season. Yeah. You must be hoping for the 5th promotion of your career.
Yeah, now we're into crunch time now. Last 10, 11 games. We give ourselves a great chance of getting promoted. It's always hard. There will be twists and turns towards it now, the end of the season. But like you said, if I can get another promotion under my belt, I've never been promoted from League 2 before. It's my second season, isn't it? So hopefully we can get that done and not play against Swansea because I want Swansea to stay up, but go back into League One. And we've got a good club here, really enjoying it. Good manager, good staff, and good owners as well that treat us the same as they would treat anyone else. They want everyone to be together, so everyone at the club has a say. It's not like some of the chairmen around, you wouldn't even know that, they wouldn't even know your name, or you wouldn't even go and speak to them. These want everyone to be involved, so it's a good club, and hopefully we can get over the line.
Well, we wish you all the best. Thank you for having us. Cheers. And you're welcome back in Swansea anytime.
Cheers, thank you for having me. Cheers.
Thank you.
Cheers.